Hello everyone, good morning. Let's get started with the 20th MuleSoft meetup, which is like Anypoint MQ monitoring and Anypoint monitoring and the MQ integrations. So which will be delivered by Manpreet. Moving over to the next slide. Yeah, so these are some guidelines while we are using Bevy. Have yourself muted all the times. I've made you the presenter. If y'all are having any queries and stuff, y'all can write on the chat section or the Q&A section, or y'all can unmute yourself so we have a healthy two-sided conversation and it doesn't get boring. And after the meetup, you'll be getting a feedback form. So let us know your feedbacks and your views on the meetup, if there is anything else which comes up. If you want us to introduce anything new, we'll just incorporate all the feedbacks. Part next. Yeah, to introduce ourselves, the organizers. Manish, would you like to go ahead?
Yeah, so quickly I'll introduce myself. So I'm Manish Yadav, working in Mule over nearly 6 to 7 years. Currently I'm working for Billennium as a solution architect. Yeah, I'm leading MuleSoft meetup leader from Mumbai. Yeah, thank you.
Parth, would you go ahead?
Okay. Hey, hi everybody. I'm Parth Rawat, and I have more than 5.5 years of experience on MuleSoft. I started with Mule 3.8 and presently working as an integration architect with Billennium. That's pretty much all.
Thanks.
Thank you, Akshita.
Thanks, Parth and Manish. Yeah, so to introduce myself, I've been working in MuleSoft almost right around 4.5 years now. I'm currently based in London and working with EPAM Systems, MuleSoft developer and architect. And yeah, that's pretty much about it. Y'all can connect with us over LinkedIn, Twitter, if you're having any queries and all, or reach us over WhatsApp. We have WhatsApp and Telegram group. I'll just share the link over the chat after this introduction is done. Parth, next.
Anyone new to the meetup?
Yeah, if anyone is new to the meetup, MuleSoft, and would like to introduce yourself to the community, y'all feel free to do it. I mean, y'all have been made the presenter. So yeah. Sometimes y'all might also get some issues with Bevy platform, just bear with us. And that should be pretty much it.
Yeah, I think it's because of weekend, people are not interested to speak. They wanted to finish early
yeah,
as possible.
Early morning, Manish. Yeah. 6:30 here, 7:30 at your place.
Yeah. So let's go ahead. Yeah, next slide, Parth.
Yeah, there are some important announcements and latest updates from the community, which we would like to just keep forward. So recently, like this week, Wednesday, Thursday, there was a TrailerX sponsored by Salesforce, which is like which is a developer community event. So it has been successfully executed. There are several videos and stuff going on. There were several sessions which were been delivered. Maybe you all can just check out what happened there and stuff later on, if you all didn't get chance to register before. And the Anypoint Studio 7.12 has been released. You all can just check out the specifications and stuff. I'll share all the links with you all in the chat section. And Anypoint Flex Gateway has been a new product which has been delivered, which ensures that you all are having ultra fast security configurations and stuff. Like we are having Anypoint Manager. So Anypoint Flex Gateway ensures that all the APIs, no matter where they are, you are able to manage all the APIs securely. You're able to implement the security stuffs on them. So Manish, would you like to add something on this?
Flex Gateway, as Akshita mentioned, right? So irrespective of what technology you have developed, so we are not forcing you to develop your API in MuleSoft only. It's like, depending on your strategic tool of the organization, you can develop your API in Python, you can develop your API in Java and any other JavaScript or any other technology, and bring them on Anypoint platform to host over the API manager or exchange documentation, so that you can onboard any business as a self-service user, or you can apply all set of policy, whatever the policy applicable for API manager. So this is something that bringing another technology into Anypoint platform, that's all in single word. Yeah. So you can see the right side, there are a couple of technologies.
I'll just share some blogs as well, which yeah. Like, as a tutorial, they have been like good to like get started with a new product.
Yeah. So yeah, that's all from Flex Gateway side. Yeah.
Next slide, back. Okay, there has been one slide missing, I guess, here. So we have MuleSoft Connect, which is coming up like on 29th of June. So I'll just share the link with you all for the Connect slide. And apart from that, if you want to register yourself as a MuleSoft mentor, I'll just share the link for that as well. So mentor is something like if you are planning to become a community ambassador or meetup leader, maybe mentor is something, a fundamental step you can get started with and make sure you're contributing to the community. So I'll share the link for that in the chat section. And that's it. With this, I'll be introducing our speaker for today, Manpreet Singh. Manpreet, maybe you can just go ahead with the introduction.
Yep. Thanks, Akshita. Thanks, Path. Morning, everyone. I'm working as an integration specialist at the CATSIAN Technologies here at Melbourne, Australia. I'm a certified MuleSoft platform architect and developer. I've been working for MuleSoft for over 4 years. I started with 3.9 and now I'm working on as an architect and developer. I've worked with various domains and various technologies for SOA. I have experience with Oracle, Service Bus, and Beeple as well, along with MuleSoft. That's it for my end. I'm speaking as a speaker for the first time. Looking forward for this session and thanks everyone for joining.
All the best, Manpreet.
Thank you, Akshita.
Okay. All the best, Manpreet.
With this, we hand over Thank it you. To you. Let's get through the agenda. You can share the screen. So this is the agenda for today's session. Cool.
Yeah, so basically, Manpreet, before you start, just to let everyone know that if you have any question, you can stop us and ask directly on the fly, so that it's not like that ending slide and then coming up with the question. So you can ask anytime, unmute yourself and ask anytime. Or if you want, you can make it interactive, you know, you can ask any question, we can help, and Preet, another community member who joined can help you, you know, to understand better. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, go ahead, Manpreet, over to you.
Okay. Can you confirm which slide are you able to see?
MQ integrations.
MQ integrations, right. So we'll go with the agenda first. There's been some problem with the connected screen. So just bear with me for a minute.
Sure.
Okay. So the agenda for today would be, we'll go through the MQ integrations, basics of the endpoint MQs. The error handling part, how do we handle the errors with the endpoint MQs, and a brief introduction to the circuit breaker capabilities. One of the very important and very impressive feature that has been provided out of the box for endpoint MQs, the circuit breaker capabilities. We'll discuss that as well in detail. Then we'll have the quiz and we'll then wrap up and have some networking time. So we'll start with the MQ integrations. Basically, what is endpoint MQ? Anypoint MQ is basically it's a multi-tenant cloud messaging service. Like we have for messaging services, we have JMSs, we have
RabbitMQ. Just a minute.
Yeah.
Can I just maximize the screen? The PPT?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Thank you. Sorry, can't
No worries. Let me know. Is it all good? Are you seeing the three screens kind of thing?
Yeah.
Okay, just a minute.
Can it be the entire one? Yeah.
Let me share once more. Let me stop sharing and then share it again. Cool. It's probably because of the connected monitor. I think now it should be okay.
Yeah, this is better. This one.
Okay. So as I was saying, Anypoint MQ basically it's a multi-tenant cloud messaging service that enables us to perform advanced asynchronous messaging scenarios between the consumers and the providers of the messages. Just like RabbitMQ and ActiveMQ, this is the same kind of functionality, but this is particularly managed by MuleSoft by Anypoint, and we have the dedicated console provided over the MuleSoft Anypoint platform. Along with it, it offers your role-based access and it offers you client management and connectors and other things as well that we'll see in the details to come. So what are the features of Anypoint MQ? We'll just go through these and elaborate with one liner. Queues and message exchange. We have queues. We have FIFO queues. We have message exchange, which we'll see in the slides to come. As I mentioned, we have a management console wherein you can see everything about your MQs and control and manage the MQs. We have a dedicated MQ connector, AnyPoint MQ connector. We have all the usage information. Basically, the owner of the owner can check what are the usage of the MQs, how many messages have been in and out, and what are the charges, and what are the number of requests that have been through the message MQs. It is provided with the sorry, someone's saying something.
No, Manpreet, you can just go ahead. Okay.
So we are provided with the REST API for the AnyPoint MQs, and it is an environment-based and a role-based access control wherein we can control our MQs on the basis of the environments, and it is also provided with the client management. Like we have client ID and client secret to control the who can access the MQs. We are given a large a facility manage the large payloads, which can be every message can be up to 10 MB. Then we have disaster recovery. So disaster recovery means all the messaging services that we are using, it is designed in such a way that they are deployed on different AZs, different availability zones within a region. And if one of the region is down, your service will still run perfectly all right because it is deployed to other regions, to other availability zones as well. But if all the services, all the regions, all the availability zones in that particular region are down, only then your service will be affected. But the messages will be retained, which are the messages which have come in before the service was interrupted. They will be retained as soon as one of the availability zone is back in that particular region. So it gives you an option of a disaster recovery by itself. Delayed delivery for messages. We have an option for queues wherein we are provided with a feature wherein we can control when the message is delivered to the subscriber. Before that, it will remain in the queue, but not be delivered out of the queue. Then we have an encrypted queues. If you enable the encryption on the queues, the payloads will be encrypted by the AES 256 GCML side. So that these are the basic features of MQs. I will start queues first. Queue basically it's a temporary storage that enables you to communicate with the consumers, and the providers can put the messages into the queues, and the subscribers can consume the messages from the queue. It gives you a reliability wherein your messages will always be processed even in the case of failure. There are ways of handling the messages even in case of failure. We'll look into that. One of the method is dead letter queue. I will look into that in the slides to come. Then we have decoupling. Decoupling means all the consumers who are consuming the messages from the queue have their own lifespan, have their own life cycles and maintenance windows, which can process individually, and they don't have to affect the other consumers of the service. Then we have aggregation, means multiple message producers can publish the message to a single queue, which can be easily consumed by the consumers. Message TTL. TTL is time to live. Each message in the queue will have a time to live. Once that is expired, the message will be expired from the queue and it will be deleted from the queue. Default acknowledgement timeout. It is the time when it says how long a message will remain unacknowledged before being returned to the queue. We will look into this detail into detail. Basically, you can. It's a time wherein you say that if a message is not acknowledged or processed within this milliseconds or seconds, the message will be returned to the queue. So next is we have unlimited messages in a queue. So there is no limit of the number onto the number of the messages in a queue, but there is a limit on the size. Yeah.
We are just having two questions. The first one is from Darshan Kamat. Can I just take them?
Is AnyPoint MQ based on SQS? That I'm not sure about. Sorry.
Okay, we'll just check through that. The second one being,
Why
are we using MQ? And he is new to MQ.
So MQ is basically, if you don't want to use, if you want to use a JMS service, like we used to have an old school, we used to have JMS messaging service, Java messaging service. This is kind of similar, but this is this comes at an expense, but this is totally dedicated and managed by MuleSoft by AnyPoint itself. So any MQs are used wherein you have a scenario, you want to perform some kind of asynchronous communication with the client, and you want to get all the messages and process them as you want to process at your own pace, depending upon the consumers, how much messages can the consumer take. And you want to have some reliability of the messages. In that case, we're going to use MQs. MQs will be MQs, just like active MQs and JMSQs. Virendra, I hope that's answered your question.
And to answer your question, Darshan, it's not based on top of SQS. SQS is the one you're talking about, the Amazon SQS, right? I'll just, but it is a kind of similar product, and it's a product which is like given to you by AnyPoint, MuleSoft. So I'll just share a link which will give you a comparison between like SQS and AnyPoint MQ, but it's not built on top of it. Yeah. I think we can.
Hey, Mantri Parthe. One more thing. How is AnyPoint MQ better than ActiveMQ or Kafka Q or various other queues available in the market? I mean,
I think one of the major reason for this one is it is built in, right? So you don't have to create a hop out of the network. You can, you know, like you don't have to deal with the third party communication like active MQs and other MQs, right? So it is built in. It's on your cloud. It's on your environment. It's within your region, and everything is right then and there. So the communication will be faster and much easier than the third-party communications, and you if you get the if you have the subscription, you can manage all your queues and MQs and everything on the endpoint platform itself, wherein you have your API manager and you have your runtime manager and all those things for your application queues to manage your queues and everything as well. So you don't have to go to a third party basically.
Okay, thank you.
So as I was saying, unlimited messages in a queue. So there is no limit on the number of the messages in a queue, but there's a limit on to the size of the message of the in the queue, which has to get to a 10 MB size. Coming to billing and charging, it is not on the number of the bill and charges will not be on the number of the queues that you have in your environment or in your region, but it will be dependent upon the number of exchanges that you create, the number of delivered messages that you do, like in and out of the number of requests that go in and out of the queues or the FIFO queues or the exchanges, that will determine your charges. And it's pretty good number. I think the beginner pack comes in with some millions of requests per month. If I'm not wrong, 5 or 50, I'm not sure, but something like in millions. You can have like millions of requests a month for the MQs. FIFO queues. Right now, we'll just go through the theory, and you know, we'll see all these things in the platform as well. So just to make sure that you know we understand the platform, whatever we do in the GUI, I'm just going to go through the theory first. So FIFO queues, FIFO, we all know FIFO is first in, first out, and you know it is most suitable for single consumers. And when a consumer is accessing a message, there is an attribute called ID, which protects all other consumers and you know to consume the same message. So therefore, you know, we avoid duplication of the consumption of the message. And if the message is until or unless the message is acknowledged or not acknowledged, the messages are not delivered. Like, you know, all they will remain in flight unless we get either acknowledgement or non-acknowledgement for the message. Message exchange, you can think about it, mule term, you can think about it as a scatter gather. So as you say, you know, scatter gather will help you publish one message to different end systems. The work of the exchange is also similar. Publisher will put a message into the exchange, and exchange will publish those messages to the queues that are bounded to the exchange. you can have the only thing is you can have only standard queues bounded to the exchange. You cannot have the FIFO queues bounded to the exchange. It only has to be standard queues wherein, you know, there is no strict ordering of the messages. Apart from this, there is one more queue which is also extensively explicitly defined as a queue, but it is a kind of it can be a standard queue, it can be a FIFO queue. It is called a dead letter queue. A dead letter queue, as the name suggests, dead letter means it will be used for the messages which are not properly delivered, which are not successfully delivered. They can be sent to the dead letter queue. And what we can do is the use of DLQ, short for DLQ. DLQ, you can look at the DLQ messages and, you know, determine what are the errors you have got, how many times we have retried, and, you know, what all happened to the message and what is the payload and all those things. We'll look into this also in detail. So basically what happens, there's a limitation to DLQ. Out of the two queues that you have, both of them have to be of the same type. If you're using a standard queue, the DLQ for that queue also has to be a standard queue. The DLQ for that particular queue also has to be a FIFO queue. And they have to be in the same region. If you have defined your queue in Sydney area, you cannot have your dead letter queue in Mumbai area. And they both have to be in the same environment and owned by the same endpoint platform account. So that is, these are the three limitations. Manisha is saying, can we say message exchange is nothing but topic? Yes, Manisha, I think that makes sense. Yes, topic is similar thing.
There are other two questions. Is any point MQ based on top of SQS and other two questions?
Manisha, we have taken that.
Went through that, yeah, Manisha.
Oh, okay. Yeah, thank you. So just to update, it is not a top of that SQS, but under the hood it is using it, because, you know, it is active MQ that we are so AnyPoint MQ is AWS capability, and already we have AWS SQS, that is queue services. Obviously they are using their services backend, but it's not, because SQS is a simple queue, but they come up with the more capabilities like what do you say, topic, exchange, FIFO, like this, right? To provide all the capability, they come up with this feature. And the beautiful benefit of this AnyPoint MQ is it's giving a circuit breaker capability.
Yep.
And that is other JMS broker, they are not doing it. And believe me, it's a great relief for the developers who's working for error handling stuff or the reliability pattern. It's a great capabilities that AnyPoint MQ is giving. Okay, so yes, it is using, but it's using in a different way.
Thanks Gaza
for adding the information.
Also, adding to Manisha's question, for MuleSoft Exchange, we can also link queues to that MuleSoft Exchange, Manisha. So you can just directly post a message to MuleSoft Exchange and it will be delivered to all the queues that are linked with that particular exchange. So that's how it can work as a topic. And to deliver a message to MuleSoft Exchange is the same way as we delivered it to a queue from our MuleSoft Studio. Sorry to interrupt, Manpreet, please go ahead.
No, all good. Thanks, Parth. So we'll see this thing in detail, but just a diagrammatic representation of what exactly do we mean by the DLQs and where are exactly the DLQs used and how is it used. So as soon as we get a queue, we say that, you know, what kind of delivery is, what kind of acknowledgement do we have. If it is acknowledged successfully, the message is consumed and we move to the next consumer. But if it is, say, for some reason it has been nagged and it has been not acknowledged, the message is returned to the queue, and then we have a redelivery policy defined to the queue, which is attached to the original queue, the standard queue or the FIFO queue. So if we are looking for it, suppose that the delivery policy is attached, then we look for the maximum delivery attempts. Say suppose you have a standard queue which has a delivery attempts of 3 times, and if it is exceeded, then we will put the message into a dead letter queue, and if it is not, then we will still wait for the next consumer. So it's just a small representation of what we are going to see in detail. So Before moving to AkinAk, I would like to go to the AnyPoint platform and actually see the MQs. So by default, MQs will not be present in your AnyPoint platform account. You will have to have a partnership and a proper subscription with the MuleSoft to be able to see your MQs in your account. The trial accounts that comes for 30 days will not have this feature enabled. So as you can see here, we have around 13 destinations. They're all called destinations, grouped as a destination. 11 of them are standard queues. One of them is a FIFO queue and one of them is an exchange. So we will look at the queue, any of the queue that we can pick, and we will just look at the options that we get. So we have the message TTL, all those things that we've just discussed, the message TTL, the time to live for a particular message in the queue. So by default, 7 days. The default acknowledgement timeout is 2 minutes by default, means how long the message has to remain before it is acknowledged or not acknowledged. And as soon as it is passed, it is timed out, the message will be delivered back to the queue. Assign default delivery delay. If you want some delivery delay to be added to the message before it is delivered, so you can add that. So by default it is 1 second, but you can increase that value. If you want to have the encryption enabled, you can turn it on, and you will have your messages encrypted by AES algorithm. It is an optional field whether you want to assign a dead letter queue or not. For this particular queue, we have a dead letter queue, which is called assign a dead letter queue option. And if you enable it, you will see the dead letter queue name. For ease purpose, we have named it as a dead letter queue. And delivery attempts before reroute. Delivery attempts before reroute means before the message is sent to the dead letter queue, how many times do you want to retry the message for success or failure? So these are the basic queue settings. Now if you go to the message sender is nothing but a GUI of something which enables you to send the message to the particular queue. If you want to send a message in a text format or JSON format or CSV format, you can do it from here. And you put your payload here, you put your delivery delay here if required. And then if you want to use any properties, say suppose you want to use a username or anything like that, you can add property and send the message. The message will be delivered into the queue. The message will be sent to the queue. Next thing is message browser. As the name says, message browser, it helps you, it enables you to browse the messages in the queue.
To interrupt you. If I am saying I'm just seeing the flow diagram only, are you on a different page?
Is it
for me or everybody?
Yeah, it's just the flow diagram.
Just 1 second. I'm not sure what's going on. I shared the entire screen, but I'm not sure what's going on.
It might have got stuck.
Can you confirm now? What are you seeing?
Now we can see the MQ screen.
AnyPoint MQ, right? Apologies for that. I was not sure. Thanks for bringing that up. Thank you.
So do we have to repeat?
Yeah, I'll just quickly go through it. So message time to live, default acknowledgement timeout, assign default delivery delay, wherein the message, the time for what you, for how much, how long you want to stop the message from being delivered before it actually is delivered from the queue. Enable encryption or disable encryption. Assign a dead letter queue and the name of the queue which you want to assign as a dead letter queue. And delivery attempts before reroute means how many the number of retries that you want before the message is actually delivered to the queue, to the dead letter queue. Message sender, you can send it as a text, CSV or JSON. Include the payload here, include the delivery delay here, and add the user property you want to add, and then you can send the message. Message browser, it helps you to get the messages from the queue. Basically, if there are, it can retrieve up to 50 messages and poll up to for 20 seconds. If you click on get messages, if there will be any message in the queue, it will be polled. And it will be displayed on your screen here in the GUI. If not, it will give you no new messages or something like that. So we are still polling for 20 seconds, and then it'll go. It'll say no new messages. But we'll stop it for now.
So Manpreet, just to add on that point, right? So when you say poll for 20 seconds, just to add everyone, so this is called long polling in terms of SQS. Okay, so when you go through the JMS or SQS based service, this is something called long polling and short polling. So this, whatever the MQ support, that is called long polling. So it wait for 20 seconds. If no message received, then again you will receive null payload in terms of mule or in terms of UI, no message or whatever. Manpreet was explaining. Yeah. So just remember this long polling concept. Any point MQ support long polling concept, because it wait for 20 seconds to pull the message. Yeah.
Thanks, Manish.
Yeah.
So the thing to note here is that this is the FIFO queue, test logging FIFO queue. And if you go into the circuit queue, if you look into the dead letter queue, you will not actually be seeing that queue, test FIFO queue. It, because it's a standard queue, you can only put a dead letter queue as a standard queue only. No FIFO queue can be assigned to the dead letter queue as a dead letter queue for this particular queue. That was just one thing to know. And if we go ahead, then what we're gonna do is we have a flow. Just give me a second. Okay, so we'll just start with a simple flow wherein what we'll do is we will put a message into an exchange. As I was mentioning, the exchange, this is an exchange that we have, KAT exchange, and we have disabled the encryption for now, and we get to select these queues. Out of these queues, we have all the standard queues only. Again, the FIFO queue is missing from here. As I mentioned, FIFO queues cannot be bound with the exchange. So what we have chosen is we have exchange queue 1, exchange queue 2, exchange queue 3 here. They're all binded to the CAT exchange. If you want to bind more, you can bind them as well. And it is we have a message sender as well. I just make sure the service is not running. And if you send a message in a JSON format, for example, if I send a simple form message here, simple JSON message, if I'm sending here, and if I click on send, what should happen is that in all these this one particular message should go to exchange Q1, exchange Q2, exchange Q3. Now, right now, if we go ahead and look into the message exchange, so now we have one message in the particular queue, exchange Q1, one message in exchange Q2, and one message in exchange queue. So one message in exchange Q3 as well. If you go into the exchange Q1 and you go to the message browser, and we will poll for a shorter period of time, shorter number of messages. And if you go here, that this message has come in on 30th of April, 6:08 UTC time, I think it is. So we have received the payload. Every payload, every message will have a message ID. This is the ID for the message, and these are the properties, the attributes, like what is the payload type, what is the date created, and what is the payload size. Now, there are two options to this particular queue. What you will see, one is the in queue and one is the in flight. In queue is when you have the message at stationary position in the queue itself. In flight is not in the queue right now, but somewhere is processed right now. Why you see it in flight right now is because we polled the message, and therefore it is on its way back to the message right now. Probably if we'll return, if we'll refresh it, we should be able to see it in queue. Right now it's in flight mode, but basically these are the two things, in queue and in flight. It will take some time and get it back into the queue. And then we have purge messages and delete. Purge messages, what we'll do is irrespective of what is the status of your message, whether it's in queue or in flight, if you click on delete messages, it will purge all your messages from the queue. It will delete all the messages basically. But if you go for delete will delete the queue. So you don't want to do that unless you're very sure about it. So delete and purge messages. Apart from this, you have the properties of your queue. What is the type? What is the ID? What is the TTL time? If there is any DLQ attached to it, you will see the DLQ as well. for this particular queue subscribe with DLQ, we have a dead letter queue attached, and the maximum retry attempt is 3 for this particular one. So what we will do is, as soon as we will start the message, start this flow, we have 3 subscribers for all those 3 queues, Q1, 2, and 3. So as soon as we will start the service, these all 3 messages will come here and will publish the message, and we will see the payload of the message. Now I'll come next time, any point MQ operations that we have, ACK, consume, NAC, publish, and subscriber, before actually going further. And let the service
run. So Manpreet, sorry to stop you. Just wanted to check with the community if they have any question or anything they wanted to interact with you or with anyone in the team. So any question from anyone, they can unmute themselves and they can come up with a question, or you can interact directly with Manpreet or with us or anyone in the community, I would say. So anyone interested? Any question on the any point MQ if you're looking for?
One question I have. We have an option for text, JSON, and I believe CSV, right? And why we don't have the option for XML? Because this is again a messaging format, right? Why they didn't put XML option? It's just an out of the box, it's not related to anything, just for a knowledge, why we don't have the XML? Anybody have the answer? And the second question is, the exchange, why it's not binding with the FIFO? Although exchange, what it will do, it's the job of the exchange is just to get the message and spread it. It's nothing to do after that. Why it's something like, why we are not binding the FIFO? Any particular reason?
No. Manish, go ahead, please.
Yeah, so the coming to the second question, Gaj, I'll come to the first question also, okay? So this, the not binding the FIFO to the exchange, right? So if you see the consuming pattern in terms of queue, right? So where the queue are basically, I don't know what to call in English, but it's like in normal term, hungry, right? To receive the message from the exchange, right? And if you keep FIFO queue, other queue will feel something like, you know, we don't have a message to receive, or, you know, you can't maintain the order for the consuming pattern. So there is a concept called consuming pattern. If you go through the JMS implementation or SQS implementation or any of the Solace queue implementation, consuming pattern. So where, you know, if you keep the FIFO, the other queue will feel like I don't have a message, and the exchange will deliver to the particular FIFO queue in terms of order. You got my point or not?
Just to try to just to understand, exchange is something we are pushing or publishing the message. After that, its job is to spread it, nothing to getting the knowledge or something, right? It's just a fire and forward.
Correct. Right?
So the thing is, as and when the messages came to the FIFO, it's not related to other also. Right? Mm-hmm. The question is why we are not able to attach the FIFO. FIFO is meant for obviously the different purpose. If you want to sequence, then we have to use it. Otherwise, there is no sense to use it, because it's a big problem if we have a FIFO, because FIFO will not parallel processing. It is a synchronous as already, right? So I'm digesting it, by the exchange is related to only queue, just to find a proper solution on this. Just out of curiosity, I'm just searching this answer.
I got your point exactly. Go ahead.
I had this concern, this question as well, but I did not find a specific answer for this one. But I think it has to be something with the order of the messages. Maintaining the order of the messages could be a little tricky when it comes to an exchange. And if you put in a lot of messages in exchange, and it's putting the messages, spreading the messages across the queues, could be a little difficult to maintain the order of the messages with the FIFO queues instead of the standard queues, wherein there is no strict order of, you know, order of the messages. I think that is only, that is the only valid reason that I could think of could be an issue, but I did not really find a proper answer from
you. Yeah, might be the one reason, but again, if we have a FIFO queue, we can put a number of messages into that, right? It still maintain the order. It's not a big reason. Might be there is a something we don't know right now, and it is not mentioned in the document as well. We
I mean, with respect to that also, right? Might be I do not have proper answer, but with respect to what Manpreet mentioned, and one thing I can sense that this number of queue, number of message, right? You can fetch from the queue side, but again, this is nothing to relate with the exchange, because exchange job is just to publish the message to the queue let other queue can handle based on their type, whether it's a standard or whether it's FIFO. Okay, so I'll do one thing. I don't have a proper question, a proper answer for that, but yeah, for sure we'll so Akshita, if you note this question, might be we can take with product team and we can get back to you, Gaja. Okay,
I will even I will search it, and if I find something, obviously we'll post it.
Great. And also, if you go through the consuming pattern, might you will get something. Okay.
Yeah. Then I will try. I will try. I will find some, you know, some sort of information why it is not related to that. We have to connect with the topic part. Why it is, because in topic case, na, there is no FIFO and all. It came with the exchange only. That's why it is tricky. That's why it's tricky here, and that is questions came in mind. Otherwise, in a topic, we have a simple queue, fire and forget.
So as I was saying, that we have a subscriber here which is subscribing to the queues, exchange Q1, exchange Q2, and exchange Q3. As soon as we started the service, we published the payload, and we see all these coming from exchange Q1 have published the payload, exchange Q3 has published the payload, and exchange Q2 has published the payload. Now, what we'll do is move to the consumer, to the operations of AnyPointMQ. Let me know once you can see the screen and the PPT again. Can you see the AMQ operation ACK now? Akshita, Manish, can you confirm?
AMQ operation is it.
And do you see it in full screen now? Or?
But it's like coming in. No, it's not in full screen. It's in partitions.
Okay. Just a minute. Yeah. Okay, I think now it should be okay.
Yeah, now it's fine.
We'll go to the operations now. ACK, one of the operation is ACK. ACK is short form acknowledgement, wherein, you know, we execute an acknowledgement indicating that the message has actually been consumed from the queue, and it can be deleted from the in-flight status of the queue, wherein there are three modes of acknowledgement. One is the immediate mode. It's basically, you can say immediate mode is when you acknowledge the message as soon as you have received it, or as soon as you have consumed it, even before processing them, you are saying that, okay, we have consumed the message, you can delete it from the queue, and you can move the message from in-flight. You can move the message from the in-flight status. The second one is automatic. Automatic, what it'll do is it'll recognize whether the flow has successfully completed or not. If it is completed successfully, it'll say, okay, we have received a success, and now we can delete the message from the queue. Third one is manual. Manually, if you're going to do it manually, you will have to control the acknowledgement at your own. You have to have the app logic, or, you know, some MuleSoft logic or error handling logic or whatever you want to do before the message is actually acknowledged or not acknowledged. After ACK comes NACK. NACK is basically not acknowledging or negative acknowledging. What it will do, if you NACK a message, if you negatively acknowledge a message, it informs the broker that, okay, there is a NACK received for this particular message, and it has not been processed successfully. Put the message back into the in queue mode from the in flight mode for the next consumer to be available. Whoever is going to consume the message next, they can pick up the message again. Consume, what it'll do is it'll just, as the name says, it'll consume the message from a queue, but it'll consume only at a time, and it can be from any destination. It can be from FIFO. It can be from the standard queue. But depending upon your strategy, whatever acknowledgement strategy you are using, it'll then take ACK, NACK, or whatever automatic or immediate, whatever you say. You can do it at your own, but it'll just take one message at a time from the particular queue. Publish will publish a message to a queue, to an AnyPoint MQ, and send it to a specific destination. It could be a queue or a FIFO queue or a message exchange. It can even send a message to a message exchange as well. So with this, the good thing about publish is you can enrich your payload. Along with sending the payload to the queue, you can also add your headers and properties, attribute properties, and all those things that you need to enhance the message. Subscribe, the one that we subscriber is a source in the AnyPoint MQ connector, which enables you to listen to any of the destination. Could be queue, could be FIFO queue, and could be the exchange. Not the exchange, but could be the queues, standard queues, and the FIFOs that we have. And we can configure different listening strategies that we'll just see depending upon the performance and predictability and schedules that we will just see. Akshita, can you confirm if you're looking at the AnyPoint studio now?
Yes, the studio. Yep.
Okay, thank you. So what we will have now, I'll just show the subscriber configuration. So subscriber, if you look into the subscriber configurations, you have the display name, basic configuration settings. So it includes your AnyPoint MQ will include your URL. This URL will come from your region, whatever region you are working upon, and this is the URL. You can copy it from here and put it there. All the regions will have a different endpoint, HTTPS endpoint. I'm based on Sydney, so my region is Sydney, so I'm working on AP Southeast 2 region. So we put in the client ID, we put in the client secret. The client secrets can be obtained from your client apps. So we have different client app. You can basically to authorize your consumers, you can create the applications just like we do in the API manager. You will get a client app ID and you will get a client secret. And that particular consumer will be authorized to listen to the queues and the FIFOs and everything here. So once that is done, we go back to the subscriber. I go back to this one, yeah. So you give the name of the queue here. You give the name of the destination here. And what we have other than that is the acknowledgement mode. Okay, so the acknowledgement mode by default is auto, as the message is delivered successfully and the flow ends with success, the message will be deleted from the queue. You can choose to be immediate, you can choose it to be manual. But if you go for manual, you have to use the ACK and NACK to acknowledge the message, whether it's been successfully delivered. We'll look into that as well. Acknowledgement timeout. Acknowledgement timeout is nothing but the duration for which the ACK or NACK is wait. The consumer is, the queue is held, the message is held basically before the consumer either acknowledges the message or not acknowledges the message before it is actually put back into the queue. The timeout unit for this is the timeout unit for the acknowledgement timeout. The other thing that I wanted to show is the error handling. One of the way of error handling will be discussed, but before that we look into the consume way. This is the consume operation. So consume, what it will do is you give
just a minute. Yeah.
yeah
we just have a few questions. Do you think we can take them?
Yeah, can you please show how to create a client app? So if you go to your client app, you click here, you give your client app name. And as soon as you do that, you get your client ID and client secret. So you can just copy the client ID and copy the client secret. When you configure your MQ configurations, you can put the URL here. You can put the client ID here. You can put the client secret here. Obviously, you get these features as well, but we are not using it for now. It's a region and business specific group which you showed. Yes, Rahul. So that is actually business based upon the URL that you are choosing. And this NQs and everything are based upon the environments and on the business group as well. So whatever business group you are choosing, the client ID, this client ID will not work in other business groups other than this one, right? That you have your current application maintained upon. Can queues from different region communicate? It depends. I think there's no reason why they can't communicate, but it's just that you have to have a proper MQ configuration. If you put an MQ configuration to publish the message from Sydney, to consume the message from Sydney region and to put the message into Mumbai region, you can definitely do that. But you have to have a different different authorization or different configuration. MQ configuration should differ for both the queues. If you give the URL AP Southeast here, and if you look for a queue which is in Mumbai, it will give you an error, queue destination not found or something like that. What is the difference between Topic and Exchange? I think we went through this one. Topic and Exchange, there's not much different, but Exchange is a different way of doing the same thing. Like we are, binding different queues to an exchange, but then spreading the same message to the queues that are bounded to the AnyPoint exchange. Does AnyPoint MQ have a message replay functionality? Message replay, I'm not able to understand this properly. Message replay means?
Yeah, so I will just answer this question, Manpreet. So other messaging service like Solace, I would say they do have a concept called message replay, which means if something get fail or automatically it will go to the replay queue, and then you have a time window, you know, that you can reprocess the same message between this time window to this time window to, you know, to replay the message or to process the message again between this time window. So yeah, AnyPoint MQ doesn't support the replay message, just to add answer to the question, I would say in short. But other messaging service like Solace have a replay message you can directly go through. Yeah.
One thing, Manish, here, if we have a time to live and if we give the maximum retry attempts of 3,
exactly,
and give us negative acknowledgement from our studio code, it will come back again. And after 3 attempts, it will go to dead letter queue. So that's kind of the replay mechanism.
Exactly. Kind of, yes.
Yeah, but that's a automatic, right? That's it. Like manual replay is something different, where you have a button to replay the message between this window to this window. Okay, so that's a correct. This is what you can arrange, or you can reiterate, or you can sync with like this, what we explained. But replay is something different in another way, in another queue. But yeah, you are right in terms of AnyPoint MQ.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is it just retry strategies? Different JMS brokers have their different retry strategies. AnyPoint MQ come up with their different strategies. So obviously you will not get the similar things, but you have the alternatives. So you have to deal with the capabilities that AnyPoint MQ have and use that. Believe me, when you use that, you will forget about the others' capability, the others' tools have, right? So it's all about the tools, what they provide. Obviously, you have their scenarios, have your requirements. If you then you have to think how we can implement it. And AnyPoint MQ, it is smart enough, it's already know. We have a retry strategy as a connector level also. If you want to retry strategy on the message queue, you can put it, retry in the queue level also. Even after that, you are not satisfied, we are come up with the dead letter queue. Right? Yeah. And they have a circuit breaker as well. If still might be, if we have issues with the connectivity, still we want to automatically get connected and then reprocess it. This is something is not with the Kafka or others, right? So this capability we have, there is multiple ways to do that. Just go through the fully capabilities or AnyPoint MQ. Believe me, you will find all the answer there. And more than that, even.
Yeah, just to add, as Ravi mentioned, as long as you have the client ID and secret and the URL, you can communicate with the queues from wherever you are, and if you just have to have the author. integration, that's all.
On this topic, Manpreet, one more thing.
Yep.
There sometimes from the runtime manager, if you see our workers are deployed on a different region, and it can be across, can be worldwide in any region, okay? And if our Anypoint MQ is on a very different region, can they work? Can a worker and this thing MQ be connected?
Yeah, it's they can be, but obviously there would be some delay. If you're deploying your application on in Sydney and your MQ is on, it's also in Sydney, it will be faster. But if you deploy your application in some other region other than Sydney, and they can communicate, but it's just that it might take some time because of the latency. That's all. There is no, as Ravi said correctly, that as long as you have the correct credentials and the correct URL, the correct region that you're looking for, you can pick up the message from the queue.
But every region usually have different encryption strategies and their policies. So, suppose yes. Sydney have some a particular country have a different data sending policy and the other country. So are we following all those standards as well before transmitting the messages from different regions?
This one doesn't, I would not call it as a feature or the limitation of Anypoint MQ. You have to be very careful about which a region are you working in, and which is the queue, what kind of payload are you transferring. Even if you want more security, right, even if you enable the encryption, it is like AES payload, right? But if you want further restriction, or if you want further encryption, right, we generally what we do is we take it as a habit of encrypting the payload even further before putting into the queue. So that can also be done to enhance your security. If you don't want to put it in, if you have any sensitive information, you can always mask it and all, but if you want further encryption, you can always encrypt the message before putting it into the queue. That is also another thing that you can add.
Okay. Thank you, that helped, yes.
So I'll quickly move, I'm not sure about the time, it's already like 12. So what we will have, we were discussing about the consume here. So consume, as I mentioned, you mentioned the name of the queue that is from, the acknowledgement mode, again, immediate or manual only, there's no automatic here. By default, it goes as an immediate one. Now we have an acknowledgement timeout unit, which we have already seen. Now we have a polling time and polling time unit for a consume operation here. What it means is, since it will pick only one message at a time, as I mentioned, right? And if you give a polling time and polling time unit here, say suppose if you have five messages in your MQ right now, this call will work perfectly fine for the first five times. But as soon as you hit it again, and if you have a value mentioned here, 20 seconds, the sixth time it will stop. It will poll the queue for 20 seconds and look for a new message. If it doesn't get a new message, it will give you an error saying that there is no message available in the queue. But if you want to avoid that kind of thing, right? Even if you don't put anything here, you will get a default timeout of 10 seconds. Okay, so. For the sixth time, it will still poll the queue for 10 seconds, and then it will give you an error that no new message has been found. But if you want to avoid it, and you put a zero here, when you put a zero here, it will still poll for 10 seconds, but it will not give you an error. It will say that, okay, no new error, but you'll get a 200 HTTP status when, for example, if you come in this particular scenario. So this thing has to be kept in mind when using consume, what is the polling time that you want to give? And you might want to handle the error wherein you get no new message kind of error. So that is one thing about consume. Now, if we look into publish, I'll just quickly look into publish before we go into deep dive into. So I'll just explain the publish operation here. So it gives you same thing, any point configuration wherein you can configure your queues and everything, configure the destination queue. And you can, one thing you can do is you can configure your payload. What is the body of the message that you want to see in the GUI? And what are the user properties that you want to see? So here we are transferring, here we are sending four different properties. We are sending correlation ID, we're sending a variable called count, last failure timestamp, and the error. So I'll explain all these things in detail, but this is basically how we can, this is the good thing about Publish, that we can select what we want to send, enrich the payload with the user properties as well, customize user properties. So that's about the five operations. If somebody has any questions, I'll just go through that. Can we accept?
There is one question from Rupesh.
So accept only desired message in MQ. Do we have any message selector here? This thing generally works for a FIFO messages, wherein we have a message group ID, and you can just show. And you can actually group the messages with the particular ID, and if you create a FIFO queue. Cancel it. And if you send a new message, so you get a message group ID, wherein, you know, what will happen is a particular group of consumers will be able to read the message from ID, but I'm not sure if we have any message selector or message selector.
No. Yeah, so Manpreet, just to add, correct. So you're right. Yeah. So in terms of pure message selector in JMS term, the AnyPoint MQ doesn't support any message selector based on the field value or based on the user property or whatever you are expecting, right. Rupesh. So it doesn't support. But yeah, the FIFO for message group ID, you can force consumer to consume this group message ID only. But yeah, in terms of your question, no.
Standard the queues, there is no message selector. JMS queues, basically, you have that. So is there anyone, what is correlation ID? Why are we using it? Basically, correlation ID is something which is used to connect the request and response. Correlation ID in terms of HTTP is the ID which lets you know whether you've got a response for a particular request or not. So it flows from HTTP request, and it also can flow in the like the message IDs for all these queues that we saw. That is a correlation ID for the HTTP requests. For example, if you look into all these messages will have an ID. So similar kind of 32-digit alphanumeric value, UUID, will be assigned to all the messages, which will be, for HTTP terms, we call it as a correlation ID. Okay, unique identifier properties. Yeah, UUID, as I mentioned, correlation ID. Okay, so next thing what we will look into is the error handling. Explain it diagrammatically. I'll just explain it diagrammatically first.
Okay, so this sounds okay. You any correlation ID, correct? Yeah, but AnyPoint MQ doesn't support this ID, right? Or correct?
No, they doesn't support means they have a message ID, a message dot ID, wherein you can get it from the attributes. Yeah.
So, correlation ID is different from message ID.
Yes. So I will swap the screen. Okay. So now, just a quick example considered of the time. What I've tried to show here is the error handling framework kind of thing, wherein we are getting a message from the experience API, wherein the experience API is actually subscribed to a queue, and they're passing the message to the system API, denoted by EAPI and SAPI respectively. So the experience API will actually fetch the message from the queue. And then what we'll do is we will check in a property called count coming into the message. If the property count is available in the message, then we will check what is the value of that particular message. If it is the first time the message is coming in, the value will not be available, obviously. Then we will put it as zero. But if it is, suppose it has been tried, it is the second attempt of the message to be retried, then the value of count will already be present. So as long as it is less than three, the message will be sent to the further process to system API. System API will then attempt to process the message and publish to the end system. There can be three scenarios. One is system API has received a successful response, and then it is sent back to the EAPI, experience API. Second is we can get some kind of business data or business or error or data error from system API, which will be handled in a different way. And third is there could be an HTTP connectivity or any kind of unforeseen errors which can not be a business data, but some kind of connectivity error, which might be resolved within some span of time, and we might want to retry the message before actually sending it the message to an error queue or the data to queue. So diagrammatically explaining the same thing, the message will be subscribed from the EAPI, from the experience API, from the queue, and then we will try to look for a property called count or retry count. If it is greater than or equal to 3, we will put the message into a data queue. If it is not, then we will process it, pass it on to the system API, and the system API will then pass it on to end system. Now, the end system might send a business error. In that case, there is suppose there is an email in the payload, right? And the email is invalid. As per the end system, it says no, you don't have a valid email, and you know there is no point of retrying the same error again and same payload again and again. So instead of sending it to a dead data queue or sending it back to the source queue, what we will do, we will say it is a business error, and we will put it into an error queue. But say suppose there is some connectivity error or some kind of error which can be an intermittent error, right? So in that case, what we will do is we will enhance the message, enrich the message, and publish it back to the message queue. Now, how will we enhance it? We'll see in detail. What we can do is we can just put the original payload and the error details into the message, and then we'll put it back into the message queue. Experience API will again pick up the message, check the count. If it is greater than 3, then yes. If it is not, then it will repeat. So this is a manual retrial of your queue, wherein there is no dead data queue, and we are manually putting the message into a dead data queue. We will also see how do we do it with a dead data queue, and we will also see how to do it without a dead data queue, and what is the difference. So this is a diagrammatic representation. Now, talking about the code for this one. So here we have a subscriber queue with a dead data queue. I'll just explain the queue. So the name of the queue is subscribe with DL queue. Now, if you look into the subscribe with DL queue here, you will see the message TTL of 7 days, default acknowledgement timeout of 2 days, 2 minutes. Now here we have assigned a dead data queue, and the dead data queue name is dead data queue. Delivery attempt before retroute is 3, means the message will be retried thrice before it is actually sent to the dead data queue. What we have done here is it's a simple, very simple flow wherein we are subscribing a message from the queue, and we are publishing start of the flow. The ACK token is very important to save here because we are going with a manual acknowledgement. So the acknowledgement mode is manual here. And if you go for a manual acknowledgement, you have to ACK or NAC the message yourself. So for successful implementation, we are sending a NAC. For in unsuccessful implementation, we are sending a NAC, and we'll show how. And if your message is completed successfully, it will take as a NAC, as an ACK. So what we'll do is we will put save variable here, and we'll save the ACK token here. And just to replicate the error scenarios, what I've done is if the payload dot ID is equal to 2, we will raise a data error. If it is, we are publishing the message to a queue which is a non-existing queue. So this is something that you might see. So the destination name is a non-existing queue, which is a non-existing queue actually, and we will obviously get an error here that so this is the kind of error where we are replicating a connectivity error, you can say, right? So unforeseen errors, connectivity errors, something like that. And if it is other than 2 or 3, we will publish the message to the publish queue, and everything's good, all happy flow, we will exit the flow. Now, what happens in case of data error? When we receive a data error, when the payload is equal to 2, we come to the error ionic propagate, and we publish the message to the error queue. Because it's a data error, there is no point of retrying the message again and again. So we will put the original payload into the error queue. And if you want, you can even publish the error details and all those things as well. And then we ACK the message. Why do we ACK the message? We ACK the message with the VAT token, ACK token that we saved, so that the message can actually be removed from the queue, and the broker can be informed that, okay, we have successfully handled the error or handled the message successfully. Now you can ACK the message, the original queue, and remove it from the in-flight status. Say suppose there is any non-existing queue error scenario wherein we have received a connectivity error. So what will happen in that case? We will NAC the message. NACing the message, what it will do is with the same ACK token, we will NAC the message and send it back to the queue. Now, the queue has been designed in such a way. The queue has been designed in such a way that it already knows that I have to retry the retry the delivery three times before I actually send it to the dead letter queue, right? So what I'll do is I'll just run. Okay, this is already running. We will use the postman to send the messages to the queue. Now it can be done by UI, but this is just another way of demonstrating the REST API. Since REST API is one of the feature provided by the endpoint MQ, so therefore I'll just demonstrate how we can do that as well. So all you need to do, you need to have your correct URL here, the one that we copied from there, and resource name is authorized. So you have to have a slash authorize here. Put in your client ID, put in your client secret, and use the grant type as client credentials. Now, when you send it, you will get an ACK token, sorry, access token, not ACK token. You will get an access token. Using this particular access token, what we will do is we will send a message into the queue. Now, you can also look at the message and understand that the body of the message, the ID is equal to 1, and you can ignore all these things. And we have a properties, or we have user properties as well. So we are mentioning that the content type is equal to application JSON, and we are using a property called user. Sending a property called user with the name, with the value of the property user is Catsian. Now, this is the URL or how you can send the message to the queue. You have to have your org ID, you have to have your environment ID, and this is the name of the queue wherein you are sending the message, and slash message and message ID. Message ID is nothing but just a GUID for to be assigned as a particular message ID to that particular message that you're sending, that's all. Not to be confused a lot. So if you send this message, I'm sending the message here. As soon as the message will be sent from postman, we should have it in the subscriber here. So if you look at the logs, so here we have received start of the flow and exit of the flow. So this has come at around 16466, so like just now. So this has come just now. Now that we know the message has been published to the publish queue, what we can do is we can go to the publish queue and actually look at the message. Yeah, so just give it some time and we will pull the queue and get the messages. Yeah, so since this is the GMT time, which is like minus 10 for me, so this is the payload that we have received, the success payload that we have received just now. Now we will return the messages to the queue and look for a data error. I'll clear the console before doing that. Now, what we'll do is we'll try to replicate a data error. Now, data error, what will happen is once we receive the data error, this will show a status successful because here you're just putting the message to the queue. But if you come to your actual subscriber, what you will see is you have received a data error and you have come here wherein we are saying publishing the message to the error queue right over here. So the message has been published to the error queue and the message has been ACKed. So if you go again to the error queue, so ID equal to 2. This message has come here. You had an option of enriching the message with your user properties, though we didn't do it for this particular case. But you have an option of doing that. So in this case, in this way, you can understand if the message has come to error queue, means there is no point of retrying the actual payload. You have to do some kind of modifications to the payload and look at the error, whatever you have got from the user property, and understand what is the error, and then retry your message before putting it to again back to the original queue. Now, what we'll do is we will clear the console and try to replicate the error wherein we have received a non-existing queue, which is ID equal to 3. So if you send an ID equal to 3 and the message will be published and consumed here. Now, if you look into this one. Yeah, so what happened here? So what happened here is it says destination not found, failed to publish the message into the non-existing queue. This was try number one. What happened is we nagged the message. Since we nagged the message was sent back to the queue and therefore it was retried. Because of the design of the queue, this message was retried 3 times before it actually sent to the dead letter queue. So this is try number one, try number two, and try number three. So what you will see is at the last, this is like nagged, and nagged. This has been nagged thrice. Therefore, where you will find the message is actually the dead letter queue. So if you go into the dead letter queue and get the messages. Yeah, so there it is, 649. Yeah, 649. So this is the ID equal to 3. So here you can see the message has been automatically sent to the dead data queue. You did not have to do anything about it. Since the queue had a dead data queue assigned to it, the message has been sent to the dead data queue. So this is one way of doing it. But the problem with this one is you did not get a chance to enhance your message like you used to get in your published mode. This is the automatic way of handling the error and sending the message to the dead letter queue. Is there any questions or anything that, I will just. Is there anything that is not clear or all good? Or any questions?
It is going good, but yeah, I'm just looking for a question from anyone in the community. I can't see any question in the chat, but if someone want, they can unmute themselves and ask the question in the. Ravi, Gaja, anyone, Rahul, any question on your side?
Explain very well.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm sorry that I might go a little fast because I have to cover this circuit breaker as well. That is very important, and one of the good features of AMQs. That's why I'm sorry if I'm going a little too fast.
No, I think you are going good, Manpreet. It's nothing to worry. From your side.
Thank you. So. To answer Praveen, there are two ways of doing it. One of them would be, you can consume the message using, so there are, you have to think from an architect point of view and, error handling framework, how do you want to do it? So as we said, there is no automatic way of doing it. You have to, create a job which will actually pull the messages, which can actually pull the messages using the REST API MQ. And you can actually, look at the check the messages, or you can do it using the manual intervention, go to the queue and look for the errors, look for everything, and understand what exactly is the error and try it as per the error message. So if it is a data error, there is no point of doing it again and again. But if it is communication or connectivity difference, for example, I will just try to find out one of the examples that I ran earlier. So for example, this is one of the messages. We will come to this part as well, but I'm just explaining for the sake of the question. So here you can see the user properties have been enhanced, right? The one that we showed earlier in the studio. So here you can see all these properties. What is the last time failure? What is the count? What is the correlation ID? This correlation ID, why we have it here? I have it here because we send the logs to Splunk, so therefore we can just use this correlation ID and get all the logs from the Splunk and see whatever happened with the whole transaction, like be it repeated thrice or twice or whatever it is. We can just go and understand what exactly happened. But for the sake of ease, we have modified our payload and our message in such a way that the error is also coming in. The error is also sent into the publish. Into the dead data queue, wherein if someone from the support team, for example, is looking into the message, they can understand, okay, there was some HTTP GET resource forbidden. We have received forbidden 403. So it looks like a temporary error. We can just go ahead and pick up the payload and send it back to the original queue. That can be done. That is one way of doing it. Otherwise, you can do it with the any point MQ REST API as well. Receive the messages from the MQ, consume the message, and then proceed accordingly. I will quickly jump to one more way of doing it. We will do the same thing, but in a different way. We will do it in a manual way, which will be easier and you know, a lot more explanatory as well and helpful to the person who is looking at the messages. So this is a manual way of doing the same thing, but this particular queue, subscribe queue, does not have a DL queue and applicable to itself. Therefore, there are no retries also. So if you look into the queue, subscribe queue, this is the queue. So there, everything remains the default behavior. There is no deadlift queue assigned to it. There's no retry assigned to it. So we are handling the error at our own, depending upon how many number of retries do we want to give. The difference here is, as soon as the message is received here, we are saving these four variables. So one of the variable is error variable. Error variable will, what it'll do is, if there is a property called error, it will save that error. Otherwise, it will just put as a default double quotes, a blank value. Okay. You will understand why are we doing it at a later stage. As usual, we are saving the act token. Second thing is the count that I explained, right? So if the property count is equal to null, means it is the first time ever the message is getting into getting subscribed. Therefore, we put it as zero. If it is not the first try, it is coming for the second or third time, we will appreciate the value by one. We will add one to the value of the count variable. And we will save the original payload in the original payload variable. Now, what we are doing here is manually, we are checking vars.count is less than equal to less than three. So as long as it is less than three, all good. We will take the scenario wherein it is less than three right now. So right now we have a dummy. We will go to this particular request and get a request from there and see if it is equal to two. Then we will raise a data error like I showed earlier. If it is not equal to two or if it is anything else, we will go and log the payload and send an acknowledgement. So why we are sending acknowledgement? I hope by now it's clear that we are saying remove the message from the in-flight and put it into the delete the message from the queue and delete it from the in-flight mode as well. Now I will not explain for the time of sake, I will not explain the data error because data error is exactly the same. We get the app data error raised from here and we will publish the error to the error queue. We will put the original payload here and what we will do is we will put the correlation ID, the count, the last time failure, and vars.error. So vars.error, I've saved the error here. It could be anything. If it's a business error, right? Means the payload is coming in as a invalid email or anything like that. So for the sake of it, I've just mentioned a payload.data.email is invalid. So this message will be stored in your deldata queue, in your error queue. Which will say, okay, this is the error. This is the reason why it has failed in the end system, and we have to retry it by modifying the error. What I want to focus more on is not even on the success scenario. What I have to focus upon is more of a connectivity error, wherein suppose this is the correct URL. Request response dot in at 443. Now what we will do is we will change the URL and restart the application. Just bear with me. I'll quickly do that. Okay. I don't want to save it. I want to run it. Okay. So while the application is running, I'll explain what will happen. What is supposed to happen is that we send a message, we receive an error at the request end. What is supposed to happen? First time it will come here, it will go to another continue, which is with the type any, and it will publish the error, publish the message back to the source queue. Now, why we are doing it, as I mentioned in the diagram as well, right? So if it is a connectivity error, we will put the message back to the source queue. This is the payload that we are enhancing, not the payload, sorry, the user properties that we are enhancing. We are putting the correlation ID, we are putting the vars.count, we are putting the error.detailed description as well. So this is the first time that we are doing it. Every time we receive an error, we will do the same thing as long as count is less than equal to three. So this will happen again and again and again. It can be an infinite loop because we are sending the message back to the source queue and subscribe it again, but we will do it only for, as long as this validation is not met. Okay. Now, another thing to note is one important feature of the publish that I missed. Apologies. is the delivery delay. Okay, the delivery delay right now, it is a very small time that I put, like only 100 milliseconds. But for example, if the end system is down and you don't want to retry the message being sent again for another 5 minutes, right? So what you can do is you can just put like 300 milliseconds or 5 minutes here, and it will not retry for another 5 minutes. Delivery delay means your message will not be actually sent to the queue, or your message will have a property which will be a delivery delay, and the message will not be subscribed from any of the queue for another 5 minutes. So therein you can add a delay to the message before it is being delivered. I'll save the flow. Let me check. Yeah, so the flow is running now. I'll just trigger a message, and let me clear the queue. So this is a delete queue. It has around 8 messages. We will purge all the messages for better understanding. So as soon as you purge all the messages, now you have 0, 0. Now if we trigger a flow, data error success not found. Okay, let's go with success also. This will also fail. So if you subscribe, if you put a message here, and look at the console. I hope it is running. Yeah, there you go. Yeah. There you go. So now let's understand what happened here. The message was consumed. The message was subscribed by the flow, and as soon as it hit here, it went to the error handler part, wherein it says we have received a 4 bidden 403. So this is the retry number one, wherein the count is equal to zero. Right now we have initiated, the count is equal to zero, and what happened is it sent the message back. It nagged the message saying publishing to the source queue. It nagged the message and sent it back to the queue. So this is retry number two, and this is try number three. Now, as soon as you have tried it thrice, right? So what happened at the third run is that the property count was initiated again and again and again, unless it reached 3. Now, as soon as it reached 3, we received var.count is less than equal to 3 as false. Now, the moment it happened, it came validation in Boolean, invalid Boolean. It published the message to the dead data queue. And enriched the message with all these user attributes, and sent an acknowledgement to the original queue, so that now that everything is done, you can remove the message from the original queue. Now if you go to the dead data queue, and okay, now we already received, I think, one message is here. If you go and browse the message, there you go. So this is the message, this is the original payload that we have hit. The good thing about publishing in this way is if you remember earlier, we did not get a chance to enrich the message, but when we nagged it. But now that we are handling it at our own, we are getting the original payload, and we are getting the details of the message as well, like what exactly happened with the error. So this is what has happened. Last time it failed is this. How many times we have retried? The count of variable is 3. Correlation ID for logging purpose and everything, you can use this. And this is the error. So the person looking at the message will understand, okay, this is the payload and this is the error. It can be retried because it failed because of an intermittent error or whatever reason. This is just an example. But this is just another way of handling the errors. Two different ways. One is manually acknowledging and not acknowledging, and one is the handling it with the dead data queue. These are two different ways of handling the same thing. Any questions? Let me know.
No from my side, but you explained this really well, Manpreet, the error handling part. So people understood very well this error part, which you have added the error object directly to the message, and then the operation team can directly go into the any point platform where any point MQ located, and they can directly see the message as well as the error. So this really looks good from the operation perspective, and that's good. So any thank you so much for explaining in such a way, Manpreet. But yeah, so any question from anyone in the community? Ravi, Rahul, Gaja, Parveen, any question guys you guys have, because you do have valid question. So I mean, this is not like Rahul or Ravi is asking the question, are asking the question, but it's like other people are also getting benefit. So if you have question, and if you know the answer, you can add or you can jump into the call just to help other. Yeah. But yeah, so considering the time, Manpreet, we can go ahead for now.
Yeah, I'll quickly just explain the closed the circuit breaker configuration. This is one of the best features that I believe, you know, we get with MQs, and probably the reason is you know, better than the other queues. So closed circuit breaker capability, sorry, not closed, circuit breaker capability, basically, it is one of the feature provided out of the box with the subscriber operation that we just saw. What happens is it gives you, it enables you to break the circuit as soon as we have received some particular kind of messages for some particular number of times. And it can be done for some particular number of, you know, seconds or milliseconds. What it means is, I'll just read it through, circuit breaker capability. That the subscriber source provider is bound to the error handling mechanism provided by Mule. It uses error notification mechanism to count errors related to an external service, which is known as a circuit failure. Now there are three different states of the circuit breaker state. One is the closed state, when everything is running fine, everyone's happy and everything is running to success. That is the closed state. But there are three different terminologies here. I'll just explain that before going further. One of them is error threshold. Error threshold value is how many errors do you receive, and then you decide, no, I want to break the circuit, I want to open the circuit, right? Error threshold means, say suppose you are saying, if I receive 5 errors, we will open the circuit for this particular seconds. So that number of errors is called the error thresholds. Okay. Now, what is the trip timeout? Trip timeout that you see here, trip timeout means how long you want the circuit to be open before it is, before it initially tries to send one message and then closes the circuit if everything is fine. So that is called as trip timeout, like how long you want the circuit to remain open. Third thing is on error types. On error types is what all are the error types that you want to include, which tables, which adds to the number of errors, right? If you say, I want to enable it for HTTP timeout, HTTP connectivity, or HTTP bad request or anything. So these are the on error types which you enable on the subscriber. And if the subscriber has received those particular kind of errors, it will add to the on error count. And once the on error count is reached, it will open the circuit. I'll quickly explain this transition, and then we'll go to the demo, and we'll explain it. We'll understand it better. Closed state, as I mentioned, is when everything is running fine. Closed open transition is when the number of failure occurs in a succession during message processing without successes and reaching the error threshold. Okay, when once it is reached, the circuit breaker trips and the circuit is now in an open state. Open state is when the subscriber source is not attempting to subscribe the messages from the queue, and it is waiting until the trip timeout is over. Half open is an important state. Half open is, and it's a very, very good feature. What will happen is, once your circuit is open, right, you don't want, by the time the circuit is open, there could be 100 messages in the queue coming as a backlog, but you don't want all of them to be retried again and then again failing, right? What you want to do is, what the subscriber will do is, it will pick up one message, process it, and then see if that particular message is processed successfully. Only then it will publish the rest of the 99 messages to the subscriber. So that is the best part about this one, is that you don't want, you will not get 100 notifications of the errors. You will get just one notification of the error. And if it is processed successfully, okay, good, the circuit will be closed. If it is not processed successfully, the trip timeout will be again reset. So with an example, if I explain pictorically and with an example, the closed state, wherein everything is good, normal retrieval of the messages and everything is running to success. But when the error count is greater than error threshold, it will open the circuit, and then it will not read any more messages from the circuit, right? And once the trip timeout is evicted, means say suppose you have waited for 5 minutes, now 5 minutes are over, what will happen is it will go to a half open state. Half open state will retrieve one message and attempt to reprocess it. Now what happened to the message? Did it fail? Yes, it did fail. So it will be back to the open state, wherein the timer will be reset and it will again try after 5 minutes. Okay. And it will go on and on and on. But as soon as the single message success is done, it will get to a closed state. Error count will be reset. The timeout will be reset. Everything will be reset and everything will be back to normal. And then it will process the rest of the messages. This is a beautiful feature. I will just quickly try to explain it with the help of an example. I'll just close everything else. Oh, sorry. So, explain the configuration. Just before I go, any questions with the theory part? It's a very important thing to understand, and you know, I believe it's a very excellent feature. I'm sorry I'm saying that again and again, but anything that anybody did not understand or anything? Okay, I'll take it as a no and I'll go ahead. So this is a normal subscriber, wherein we are subscribing to a queue called circuit subscribe queue. And one more thing is the subscriber type. Sorry, I missed it. Subscriber type, we have prefetch by default and polling. Prefetch is, you can take it as an on new message on DB or on new message on other connectors that we have, right? So as soon as the message is put into the subscriber, it will be picked up by the subscriber. Wherein the other option that we have is a polling. As we all might know, polling is like a fig. You want to poll it at a regular time of interval, 100,000 milliseconds by default, or you want to do it with a cron job or something. That can also be done. We will go ahead with the prefetch right now. So we are going to go with prefetch right now. Acknowledgement is manual. The main important feature comes here. So this is a circuit breaker. Into advanced settings, and you can go to circuit breaker. I have edited it inline. So these three things are important to know: on error types, error threshold type, trip timeout, and trip timeout seconds. So for the sake of it, I've reduced the time because we're gonna have to wait for 30 seconds to be over. So I didn't put like 5 minutes or something. I put like reasonable 30 seconds for the delay. But the on error types you might want to know. So what are the error types that you want to be counted as an error? One of them is HTTP gateway or timeout, and one of them is HTTP timeout right now that we have. Errors threshold is 5. Error threshold is nothing but when we are saying how many times the subscriber should get these kind of errors, and then it should open the circuit. So this is error threshold. Trip timeout, as I mentioned, how long you want the circuit to be open before it actually goes to a half open state and try to rerun one of the message. What I'll do is I'll quickly send one success message. And so we are just sending any message, random message, and we are sending it now. Let me clear it. Let me clear it. So what is happening is this is a request that I made to one of the service that I have deployed on cloud, which is cat ms and this and this and that. So what happens is the message was consumed, it published start, it went to the request, and it published the payload. Here is the payload response, hello world, and then it published the end. Now this is the happy path, right? We don't want to see the happy part. We want to see the error path. So what we'll do is I'll just go here and close the service. I'll just stop the service. So the plan is to replicate one of the on error types, which is HTTP timeout. Since we have defined that HTTP timeout if that happens, then we will see the circuit breaker in play. Okay, I think the service is out now. Now if we will, let me close this. Yeah. Now if we will put a message here. Okay. Now we'll just look at the logs now. So now it came in, the message came in, it went to the start part. Now it went to the request part and it got an error with the HTTP timeout. there was no not a lot of delay in the delivery of the message. Therefore, as soon as it has been it went back to the subscriber and it went to the start, and same thing is happening for the third time in a row. So this is try number zero, wherein the original retry number one. This is the error number one. This is error number two. This is the error number three. So this is the error number three, and let it run. So as you can see, this is the try number one, wherein we have received timeout exceeded number one, number two, number three, number four, number five. The message is still in the queue, but it is not being consumed anymore. The circuit is now in open state, right? If you look into the subscribe queue, it's right here, but it is not being subscribed right now. The circuit is in open state, so it will not subscribe right now. But now it did. Why? Because as soon as we hit the 30 seconds mark, it retried again. So for example, if you look at here, 17, 14, 55, not 55, sorry, 045. So 45, it retried and then it failed. And then it again retried at 55. Yes, for 55. Again, it retried, right? And 55, and then again at 40. Okay. So at that particular timeout interval, it is retrying again and again after every 30 seconds of the message being put back. And if I put a lot of messages in the queue, for example, if I put id equal to 3, and right equal to 4. So all these messages are available in the queue. If I refresh it, so all available in the queue, but you will not see four errors here. You will only see one error every time the trip timeout is reset. Let it just run once more. Yeah, so now it retried only with one message, if you see. So this is called half open state, right? So it is not retrying with all the four messages coming in at one and then failing. So now what we'll do is, now we will rerun the service. And now as soon as it will be able to establish the connectivity with the service and go to success, all the four messages will come in and all the four messages will go to the success flow. We'll just wait for it to deploy. So right now it is in half open state and it is running every 30 seconds with one message only. That is the thing to note. It's trying again, but it will fail, I think. That's why I just kept like 30 seconds as a timeout to get it quickly. Bear with me, it will be done in a minute.
So meanwhile time, Vanpreet, the circuit breaker capability we should use only for the connectivity part. Don't try to use for a bad request or data error, because it will not help you out in any way.
Yes. That was just an example, yeah.
Yeah, I'm saying like just in a generic use. Yes. Even though your demo is also for the connectivity only. It's not
data.
Otherwise, you will be in a trap.
Yes, exactly.
It will pick the same message again and then keep going.
So it will just keep on breaking the message, the circuit, if we go for a bad request or something. But yeah, so that's why I just explained with connectivity, because that is the most suitable example for this particular feature.
And use the dead letter queue if you encountered with the data error.
Yeah.
As soon as you get the data related, I put into the dead letter queue.
Yeah.
We have a question, Manpreet, from the page.
Just one minute. Yeah, there you go. Just 1 minute. So as I was saying, as soon as after this request failed, the service was up and running. Service is up and running now. So if you see all four messages, number one, number two, number three, and number four, all four messages have been subscribed immediately as soon as we have received one error, one fail, one success, and all of the four messages have been processed. So now the circuit is back into the closed state. That is all. Can I know how are we checking the consumer is on and the circuit can be closed? I know it's based on the threshold value, but can you please can I know how we're checking the consumer is on? Consumer is on and the circuit can be closed. So consumer is on means consumer is on. By the consumer, do you mean the subscriber?
So Dipesh, you can unmute yourself and you can come up with the explanation. This might help Manpreet or any other team member who can answer your question. Because this is something for me, it's not clear, honestly speaking.
Yes, the service you are hitting.
Target system.
Target system, right? So how do we know? How are we checking? So that is open state, right? Like half open state. If you see half open state, what it'll do is it will retrieve one message and attempt to process it. Attempt to process it means attempt to go with the flow and hit the target service, whatever was happening right over in this part. So it was picking up one message at a time and then trying to hit the service and then failing because of the service was unavailable. So as soon as the service was running, it processed one message and got a hello world response, and then it brought all the four messages that okay, now we can come in, the circuit is working now, the circuit is in closed state, now you all can come in. So it brought other three messages in the queue as well.
Yeah, just to add, this is a circuit breaker capability backend. It's in functionality in the backend. Yeah. It's checking. It's not showing to us, but this is the compatibility they are checking back and giving us the result only.
Yeah, half open.
If you will implement like custom, then you will understand and more better. You can put their logger and something, and you can see all these things. Now it is abstracted from us because they are giving us a capability. They are not showing all these things in the backend.
Manish, we are good from my end.
Okay, so thanks Manpreet. Before we go, any question from anyone, just to go to the next slide. The slide will be from our side or from the organizer side. So any question on any topic what we discussed till now from anyone, or anything you would like to add, what you know in real life? I know this is weekend, still we are taking much time or whatever the time, but anything if you want, you can just add it.
Hi, Manish. Yeah, Manish, actually, the overall session is very good.
It was quite interactive. Good job.
Also, at the same time,
thank you, everyone.
Another thing is, he has covered very well the error parts, right?
Correct. I do agree. Yeah.
And someone asked that why you want to choose Kafka and why you want to. Select AnyPoint MQ. I think that is a bigger topic, but high level people who have a very high level question. What I can say is that MuleSoft also recommends that where you have a heavy streaming of messages, we need to handle it. Then only you go to the Kafka, right?
Yeah, Kafka or any other messaging service. Yeah.
The purpose of Kafka is entirely different. Many people, what they do, they try to ask, like, why can't you use Kafka? Because they should know, right? If you are not handling streams of messages very large, it is AnyPoint MQ is very good because already it is backed with an AWS space, right? Yeah. That's what MuleSoft say. Never says that, okay, never try to sell our product for everything. Every option is not for everyone, right? So,
correct.
That's the MFR's place and very bigger role while selecting the AnyPoint MQ. Like as Manpreet Singh mentioned, right? One of the things, suppose if you really want to use because it is the part of the any MuleSoft ecosystem, so everything will be very smoother, right? Instead of using that is part of MuleSoft everything, so it will be much faster efficiency wise based on your NFRs that you are going to handle for the customer.
Correct. And just to add one, thanks for explaining, Ravi. So it depends on your strategic product also. You know, if your company is looking for MQ solution as any point platform MQ, then you can go. But if you have a in your organization, if they are choosing a strategic product as a Solace or Kafka, then as Ravi mentioned, right, MuleSoft is not telling or forcing you to use only any point MQ. So it's like you can choose any product based on your organization, a strategic product for MQ solution. So it totally depends, right? Yeah. Kafka is an event streaming reactive ecosystem. Yeah, correct. Yeah, anyone? Yeah, go ahead.
I was just saying, Manish, that for everyone, I think you will be sharing the deck, right?
I will be sharing the deck. Yeah.
Okay, so I've attached a lot of references from which I, from the Mule documentation itself. So you guys can go and read in detail about everything that we've discussed today.
Yeah, we'll be sharing the deck as well as the recording on the same Meetup page.
Yeah, thank you. I'll stop sharing now, Manish.
Manish, you can just continue. Yeah. Maybe we can go to the quiz questions as well.
Yeah, we'll do.
So,
but before we go.
So,
to add, the people who are MuleSoft ambassador, people like Ravi or other people who join are not eligible not eligible to win the voucher. This is what I can say. But sorry, Ravi, this is what, right? just to give to other people a chance. Okay. So, yeah.
So guys, there will be a question on your screen and just answer to the question in the chat. Maybe you all can give option as A, B, C, D. I guess that's what it is, right, Manpit?
Yeah.
We are having the options as A, B, C, D. Yeah. So the first five ones will be, don't go to the questions. Yeah. So the first five ones we'll put in the name of wheels like we do always, and we'll pick a random winner. So yeah, here goes the first question.
Akshita, can you confirm what are you seeing on the screen? Yeah. Are you seeing that boxes or just the complete PPT?
Yeah, I'm seeing the reference.
And nothing on the right of references, right?
References.
Nothing on the right hand side, right? Just the full screen. Now you're just seeing the trivia question only, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, let me know when to move to the first question.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, now we can move to the first question.
Okay, first question now. So, which of the following is not an operation of the AnyPoint MQ connector? Publisher, subscriber, publish, consume, ACK, or NACK?
We are having a few answers. So, what's the correct one?
No, these people are not copy pasting, at least the option itself. Some people are pasting in the capital C, writing and the small C. So, it seems that they are not copy pasting.
It's just an alphabet.
What's the right answer?
Right answer is C, publish consume.
Good question.
Cool. So we'll just take off like five names from the top who have answered first, and then we'll put in the name of quiz.
Okay. So Parth, you're writing down those names, right? Top five names, correct?
Yes, okay. Manish. So the first five are Shubham, Somil, and if I'm pronouncing it correctly, Chao, Shreyas, and Akshay.
Okay.
Cool.
Cool.
Let's go to the second question.
Yeah. The payloads are encrypted with what algorithm, with which algorithm on the server side in AnyPoint MQ? AES 256 GCM, Blowfish, RAS, RSA, or DES?
Okay. There are too many.
Oh my God.
All right. And we'll just make sure the names aren't repeating in the second one so that we get more audience.
Are you Akshita?
The answer is Parth will not repeat the names in the second one, no? The one who are there in the first slot.
What if they don't win in the first slot?
No, so yeah, so let it be Akshita. So what we can do, if they are winner, then we can remove the name. Let them get benefit,
okay,
most
cool.
of the things, okay, from our side, because we wanted to give benefit to a lot of users, I mean, to the community, okay?
Yeah.
So let them, yeah, we'll note the same name, okay? If they are winner, then we can remove from the another person, yeah. Yeah.
Cool. So the answer is A, right?
Yep.
So the names here are Shubham, Dave, Somil, Rahul, and Akshay.
Okay.
Good.
We can go to the next one.
Okay. What type of MQ should we use when the order processing is critical? Exchange, FIFO queue, circular queue, or double-ended queue?
Shubham is on fire.
Okay, then. I guess I'll start sharing my screen.
Yep, I'll stop.
The names here are the correct.
Okay, yes. Yeah, the names. Yes, Parth.
Correct answer is B, right?
Yep, yep.
Yes.
So the names are Dev, Rahul, Arvind, Shubham, and Praveen.
So, okay, Shubham is in every question. That is why someone told he is on fire, correct?
He is like okay. that only.
Okay. Okay. Let's see. Okay.
Just Shivam, confirm you get that early already or not.
Parth, are you sending me the names?
So yes, posting in the chat.
Cool. This is for the first one.
Hard work plus luck now.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm spending for the first one. Manish, please take a screenshot of photo or path. Or LT. It's sharp. Congratulations.
1 second.
And winners, please don't forget to send us your email ID and LinkedIn profile so we can reach out to you. I mean, all the details, full name, in the chat section itself. Okay. It's done, Parth?
Yes.
Cool. So congratulations, Shah. I hope it's Shah. And I'm not pronouncing it wrong.
That's fine, Akshita, as long as you have a valid email ID, that's fine.
Yeah,
LinkedIn ID, please share the LinkedIn ID as well. Yeah,
yeah, for the second one, I'm spelling the wheel. Oh, Akshay. Congratulations.
Yes, guys, please share the email ID and LinkedIn profile to the group.
Yeah, congrats, Akshay. So for the third one.
Just a second.
Okay, sorry. Huh.
We missed that. Sheet Akshay winning.
No, it's here. It's on the screen.
Okay, all right, 1 second. Okay.
This is for the third one. Dev, Rahul, Arvind, Shubham.
Akshay, please share the LinkedIn ID as well.
Yeah, Rahul, congratulations.
Actually, you should consider Shubham without this.
Yeah, maybe next time.
Yeah, congrats, Rahul.
Yeah, and sorry, Shubham.
Please wait on this thing. One second.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
All right. 1 second.
Okay, send us your detail, and now maybe you all can just turn on the camera. You're done, Path?
Almost done. I need LinkedIn ID.
So Rahul, congratulations. Please send your LinkedIn ID as well as email ID, I would say, for all people. Yeah.
Yeah. And also, guys, like if you all have taken some pictures, screenshot, or anything, any experience you want to share, you all can just tag us as MuleSoft Meetups, Mumbai MuleSoft Meetup. And after this meetup, you'll be getting a feedback form. Please do fill out the feedback form and let us know how it was. And if you're having further suggestions in terms of topics, speakers, or if you want to be a speaker, then maybe just let us know. So yeah, I just missed the slide. So if you're going to be a speaker for the next MuleSoft Meetup, then you're getting a chance to win a MuleSoft certification and a training voucher as well. And yeah, it's really a good experience to get started with. You can tweet us, you can find us on Instagram, and I've already shared the Telegram link as well. And yeah, if you're having any queries, feel free to reach out to us. I guess that's it. We can just turn on the cameras and maybe we can take some photos. Manish, I'm sorry. I know you're going to... kill me today.
Okay, no problem. I'll switch on the camera. That's what, you know, I can show my face. Yeah. How I'm looking, that's fine.
Definitely.
For me.
Hey Francis.
Hi Francis. It was a really nice session, Manpreet. Like, yeah, it was
thanks.
Really good.
Yeah, really good.
Thanks Lakshita. Thanks everyone for joining on a Saturday afternoon.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Special thanks to you, Akshita, joining like 5 a.m. waking up at 5
a.m.
Not
just me, yeah. Also Manish.
Manish, yeah. And Path as well. Thanks, everyone.
It must be late for you, right, Francis?
Early for me.
Oh, early for you as well. Cool.
Yeah, so guys, if you want, you can switch on the camera like me. Just wake up maybe for 2 hours.
Rajit, I'm not getting the option to switch on the camera for Dev.
Yeah, I guess in some cases that we do get issues. I'm not sure, like.
What about the binner? I can't see the binner except Rahul.
Yeah. Where is Akshay?
They won and they left.
They won and they left.
Give it to Shivam.
Okay. No, it happened in the past, you know, if you won the voucher and if you're not sharing your email ID and name and you left the meetup before announcement.
But they have shared the email ID.
Yeah. No issue. Congratulations once again if they are still there.
Yeah.
Great session, Manpreet. It's a great session. And the very good informations you have picked up. Although we have a different any point time Q session, but always have a different flavors. It's good to share the knowledge. Yeah.
So basically, we prefer to have a interactive session. This is what I mean. Mumbai Meetup known for.